Welcome everybody to this week's Magic TV Top 8. This week we're going pretty generic here, but we haven't gone through them before. And there was a huge list.
That's surprising to me.
It was unreal. I mean, we're talking about all of Magic.
Well, I was surprised that we hadn't done it before.
Right. Top 8 flyers. That's just crazy. Top 8 flyers. Like, you should have... To see the list of just, like, the cards that weren't good enough...
Yeah, the chat was a little ridiculous.
Yeah.
It's also, we didn't know where to draw the line. Like, is a smuggler's copter a flyer? Is you know, what was the other guy? Morphling, is that a flyer? Like...
Right.
If it doesn't naturally have flying, is it still a flyer?
Is Lingering Souls a flyer?
Yeah. Spectral Procession, right.
So, yeah. So, we cut that out. It basically, like, has to have flying as one of its base stats on the card. So, that's kind of the stipulation that we're going with. A lot of great cards didn't make the cut. You know, like, Baneslayer Angel, for example, didn't make the cut. Broodmate Dragon didn't make the cut.
And it has to be a creature, right?
And sorry, guys. Stormcrow did not make the cut. I do apologize. Okay.
Stormcrow's number one.
All right, so I have an honorable mention. Yeah, I have an honorable mention, not nearly quite on the same power level, but just in terms of like historical context and just like when you think about Magic, this is kind of one of the cards I think about when I think about flyers. Sarah Angel.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Yeah, just the art on the card. And, you know, when we talk about push creatures nowadays, we're thinking 2-mana 4/4 tramplers, 2-mana 5/6 Tarmogoyfs, whatever, right? Sarah Angel was the pushed creature back in the day.
Yeah.
Right? My computer science teacher would play 4 copies of this card in middle school, right? We would go 3v1 against him, and none of us could beat that Sarah Angel.
And you didn't have the internet either, so you couldn't just go buy Sarah Angels yourself.
Oh,
you
no.
Know?
Oh, there was absolutely no, like... not. I opened 6 booster packs, and that was my deck.
That's it. That's what you got.
And then he also had like the Royal Assassin Icy Manipulator combo, and we just
that
thought
was broken.
We
when
just
you
thought
were,
he was cheesing us. We're like, no. This has to be banned. This is too good.
Yeah, right? Like, are you using those cards correctly? Are you sure?
Yeah, this doesn't feel like it works. Do you have an honorable mention?
Yes, I definitely do. Rainbow Efreet is actually my honorable mention. It was the integral win condition of like the Drago decks back in the day, where you would play like end of your turn, 6-mana Whispers of the Muse. You know, so you would play Rainbow Efreet for 4. It's 3/1 flyer from Visions, and you could pay 2 blue to phase it out. And this, back in the day, was your Aetherling or your, you know, as I mentioned earlier, Pearl-like Ancient. You know, this was your finisher for your blue deck. And everything else just got countered. So
I think you just mentioned, like, 3 Magic cards that, like, 80% of the chat just has no idea what they do.
Pearl-like Ancient? No, oh, Whispers of the Muse. You're talking about the early ones.
The other card, Whispers of the Muse.
I was like, that was just in Khan's blog.
Yeah, those are old-school cards, but yeah, I guess that was kind of the go-to win condition back in the day. A 4-mana 3/1 flyer that you have to pay 2 mana to get phasing.
Back in my day, kids, you see...
A power creep.
We had one toughness.
Yeah. Who wins in a fight, though, that or Sarah Angel? Just
Sarah
saying.
Angel. Just saying. No, just saying. Just throwing that out there.
Now we have Archangel Avacyn, which is just Sarah Angel on.
Oh.
Yeah.
Or Baneslayer Angel.
Yeah. The angels have gotten a lot more powerful. All right.
Oh, Deviant Esquire actually said Will-O-the-Wisp in the chat.
Ooh.
Unbelievable.
Will-O-the-Wisp is a nice one. That's another kind of iconic card. Yeah.
And then Channel Fireball editor Andy and content manager Andy Cooperfaus.
Wow,
mentioned we
out.
Should put Cathari Remnant in there because that is the upgrade.
Man, calling him out. He got you on the show.
Why was I calling him out?
You were like, Andy Cooperfaus rejected Will-O-the-Wisp.
No. I was saying he one-upped me and got even better, and he said Cathari Remnant because that's the upgrade.
Oh, my bad.
Yeah. No, he's good. I love it.
All right, let's head into our top 8 flyers. Coming in at number 8, a little controversial. Smuggler's Copter. Just wait for the pitchforks. Just wait
for
it.
This card was banned.
All right. So, if you just look at the card itself, it does say 3/3, and it does say that it is a flyer. It just needs to be crewed by a creature.
Well, it does say artifact creature on it, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I believe it says, it might say vehicle.
Does it?
It might say, but it becomes an artifact creature. But this was a flyer that had to be banned. Okay, it was so good in Standard, it was so oppressive, it was all over the place, that it actually had to get banned. And just think about it, look at the stats on this card. 2-mana, 3/3 flyer, that loots. Crew won!
I mean, it's very odd. Like, there was a reason why it was in literally every deck that had a creature with a pulse on it.
Yeah. And well, I am glad that this is no longer in standard, but Heart of Kirin is doing a pretty good impression of this card.
A pretty good smuggler's copter. Yeah. Well, they're like, I don't really need to loot anymore because I'm just going to kill you four turns sooner. So,
yeah.
Is that cool?
The thing is, smuggler's copter was dumb, right? Like, think about it. Like, your Thraben inspectors could crew it. Once you drew the smuggler's copter, like, you would just never get flooded. This just did basically everything you wanted in an aggro deck. I even had this in a cube deck, and it was fantastic there, too. That's a metric that I like to use, by the way.
And, like, yeah, oh, that's a good one, actually. Yeah. I like that. And, like, your crew one is just, like, I mean, you might as well just have a crew zero, and then I can crew it with Wall of Omens
might as well just make it a 2-mana 3/3 flyer at this point.
Right. Then my Bird of Paradise can crew like it should, the way God intended.
All right. So number 8, Smuggler's Copter. Coming in at number 7, look at this. We're already going to the heavy hitters here. Restoration Angel.
This is a good one.
Yeah. By the way, the only angel in our top 8.
Oh, spoilers, man.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
So why do you think Restoration Angel was good enough to make our list?
I mean, this card was dominant in standard, like broken in standard. It was in top 8 Pro Tour top 8 lists, multiple Pro Tour top 8 lists. Pretty much every deck that played white when Restoration Angel was legal played Restoration Angel. Like, you would blinking Thrag Tusks. You blink pretty much anything. It just saved creatures. It countered spells. It was great for removal. And even now, like, it's still a staple in modern. Like, it's in multiple modern decks.
That standard format was kind of miserable, I think. Where it was mono Restoration Angels and Thrag Tusks.
Yeah, and then you're like, well, how many restos did you draw? 2? I drew 3. Kill you.
Yeah. The card was just... It was just silly. I mean, just think about... Like, even a 4-mana 3/4 Flash Flyer is already pretty good, right?
I mean, it blocks my Rainbow Freet all day.
Yeah, yeah. It kind of just, like, points and laughs at your Rainbow Freet. And, of course, not only that's rude, Paul. A combo deck as well, right? Kiki Pod or Restoration Angel with Kiki Jiki, another way to just go infinite. So this deck is
like solid flyer with flash that can literally enable an infinite combo by itself. Like, all right, well that's good.
Yeah, it'll even deliver lunch to you in a pinch. Okay, coming in, that's
angelic.
Coming in at number 6, we have Vendilion Click.
Also flash.
Flash is just an amazing thing to add onto creatures, and they should probably do it more often.
This just feels like Rainbow Freet 2.0 to me. It's a 3-1. It's blue.
You're comparing this to Rainbow Freet.
Yeah. You're going to say something real rude, so let me just stop.
No, here. I'm just going to say something factually correct.
Unbelievable. You have no respect for your generation of Magic, Paul.
No, that was a little before my time. I'm going to just say. All right, but Vendilion Click, obviously, just catch all. It's seen play in all formats, and I think that's like kind of a good marker to use when you're talking about kind of all-time greats in terms of cards. Agreed. Vendilion Click was a great card in standard. It saw extended play, it saw modern play, and it even still sees legacy play. For example, in like the legendary version of Blue White Miracles, and also just in sideboards of the Miracles decks.
Yeah, and it's also, I don't actually think, I thought it was in like some of the Sultai lists, but I'm not sure. I don't think so.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, it's still very good, and it sees play across multiple formats, and it's just, it does so many things. Like,
yeah.
It's also a wizard, so I can do cool wizard tricks with it.
I actually am very aware of this because of the mono in Extended. I played this at Worlds, where I believe Gabriel Nassif came up with this deck. It was mono blue wizards. Like Fairy Wizard Flash deck, where it had Spellstutter Sprites, Vendilion Clicks, and Riptide Laboratory. It was a lot of fun.
Yes, I loved, because I love bouncing Spellstutter Sprite Riptide Laboratory.
That is value.
That's something of a lock.
That is value. All right. Number five. We have the Jellyfish. Emrakul.
Manowar. Oh.
Not that Jellyfish. That Jellyfish doesn't fly. Emrakul, the Aeon's Torn. This thing has flying?
actually, we could have just done Mistraven, which is just flying Emrakul. So
Mistraven is also flying Emrakul. What are these comparisons? My mind, it doesn't work.
Wait, did I say flying Emrakul, or did you say that?
I just said that Emrakul had flying. Mistraven?
Okay, we're done. Mistraven is flying Manowar.
Oh, it's flying Manowar. Oh, my God.
I just got it.
What I meant, not what I said, Paul.
I just got it.
And there you go. There you go. You got it.
I don't know if you can. I'm just shaking my head. My glasses are off, and I'm shaking my head.
That's fine. I accept that.
That's been accepted now. Okay. Now, can we talk about how sweet this card, this incredibly powerful magic card, is? Number five.
I'm gonna let you finish. But Mistraven has one of the best enters the battlefield abilities of all time.
Oh, we're still talking about Mistraven. Okay. All right. Well, let me talk about this card. Wait, I messed it up. It's right here. Let me talk about this card, and not this gentleman talking about Mistraven. Let's talk about Emrakul, the Aeon's Torn. This thing is gigantic. It flies. It takes extra turns. Obviously, you know, the only way you can really play this is to cheat it into play. But back in the day, some Tron decks played this as a finisher as well, as a one-up.
Yeah, they just hardcast this dude.
Yeah, back when Iavugin was legal, you could do it. You could do it. But, I mean, this card is just completely unreal. You could take away, like, couple of keywords from this card and it would still be ridiculous, right?
Someone said in the chat, loses to Ensnaring Bridge, and I think that's a good point. Like, if unless you have 16 cards in your hand, this dude's not attacking.
Wow. With the just the heavy hitting.
I just think we should be factually accurate, and I think we need to be unbiased here about
our quality.
You know
what this can fly over, though? A moat.
Oh, touche. Yeah. Well, to be fair, all the cards on this list can hopefully do that. That's going to be super awkward if there's a card on this list that can't fly over a moat.
That is true. All right.
Actually, so there is one, technically.
Yes. Okay. So, all right. So that was our bottom eight flyers. We now have, of course, the top four flyers. If you guys want to guess what the top four is, make sure you guys write it down in the comment section below if you guys are watching this on the Channel Fireball website. And if you're on the chat, feel free to just kind of type it in. And no, Stormcrow is not on the list.
Someone mentioned Muldrifer, and that makes me sad because I forgot.
Neither is Mistraven, if you're wondering.
That's the best bird ever.
Or Manowar with Flight of Fancy on it. That also doesn't work.
What do you mean it doesn't work? It totally works. Well, I can't deal with you when you're like this.
It draws two cards. Oh! I forgot Moldrifter.
Yeah, so did I. That's what I just said.
Oh.
That's the exact reaction I had. I was like, oh, man.
Moldrifter.
That is a good fish
I'm
bird.
I'm so sorry, Moldrifter. I'm so sorry. I forgot about you.
Wait. Both of our honorable mentions right now.
Yeah. There's so many, though. There's so many good flyers.
I agree.
Oh, my God, Moldrifter. Never passed a Moldrifter in my life. Not in
oh,
Modern
no,
Masters.
Never.
Not in Modern Masters draft.
I would sooner die than pass the Moldrifter.
It's a good way to live.
It's the only way to live, Paul.
Forgot Moldrifter, list invalid. You know, that's fair.
Sorry, cancel the show, please.
Yeah, all right. We're just going to start all over. Mosh will be back next week, you know, from Australia.
Night,
he might be a little jet lag, but it's okay. Okay, number four. Let's go, top four. Coming in at number four, Squadron Hawk. Saw that one coming? I don't see a lot of Squadron Hawks up in here.
I don't think anyone's mentioned. Well, some people are mentioning it now, but yeah, I don't think before I didn't see it that frequently at all.
No, then you're gonna have that one silent guy that like typed it in like 7 minutes ago. You'd be like, I knew it, Squadron Hawk. You guys are all so right. Yeah.
You guys could scroll up if you'd like to see proof, but I mentioned it earlier.
Control F Squadron Hawk. That's all you gotta do. All right. Anyways, Squadron Hawk. How did this sneak into the top four?
It defined its own standard archetype that required banning of Jace the Mind Sculptor and Preordain. And it's also a staple in modern, like, martyr decks. So.
Yeah. Yeah. It sees some modern play in the, you know, kind of the life gain decks with Martyr Sands and Serra Ascendant. At the same time, this was the flyer in the most dominant standard deck of all time still. Right?
Oh, they were the four flyers.
They were the four flyers, right. But all you had to do was draw one. Oh.
And then they got friends. And then the squadron came out. The squad. Squad goals. Squadron goals.
What is happening? Hijacked this show. I cannot function anymore. I cannot function. This is the first time I haven't been able to function. With Mashi, I can just be like, look. But then you just keep piling it on.
I got this thing on lockdown,
with something
bro.
Like semi-clever but ridiculous.
Yeah, but it's the quantity, not the quality, Paul. Oh, like, it adds up.
But it's so much. I cannot handle this. This is just too much. just, all right. But anyway, Squadron Hawk, absurd card in standard. Of course, you just get a lot of value out of this card if you're ever playing any control strategy. It's just so hard to deal with all those flyers. At the same time, it just gave you a lot more shuffle effects with, of course, the best card, one of the best cards of all time, which was, of course, Jace the Mind Sculptor.
If that card had flying, whew. I don't know how that would work, but...
I'm going to break, Frank. I'm going to break. What? Okay. All right. Coming in at number 3, we have Gristlebrand.
That's a good dude.
that's a cool dude.
That's a good dude.
That's a good dude.
That's a solid gentleman, my friend.
That is a solid gentleman. You know, I was always wondering to myself, just kind of looking at Gristlebrand, kind of looks like a scary dude, but like I bet he lives like a really impractical life. I mean, look at his hands.
Right. How do you eat dinner? I mean, I guess you're probably just tearing things
up. How do you eat?
I don't think you're holding utensils with these hands.
I guess he's like good at cutting the steak, but then how does he like, you know? I guess he flies, so he can just kind of...
I mean, I can't vouch for Gristlebrand's eating habits, unfortunately, but...
All right, anyways, this card, obviously absurd, one of just the best kind of... If you talk about creatures that you want to cheat into play, this is just the top of the list, right? This is the best creature.
I think this and number 5 are the two you or the number 4. Number 5?
Emrakul is number 5.
Yeah, so number 3 and number 5 are the two you want. Those are your go-to guys that you just cheat into play and get their abilities.
Yeah, and that's the thing, right? Like, you have Emrakul, and there are times where like you get Emrakul and sometimes you like survive, right? You get Emrakul, you're like, "Oh, I sacked some permanents," and then it like, you know, they threw the breach that in and then it died and it was whatever. Like, I took 15.
I have 8 lands and a Primeval Titan. I'll sack 6 and kill you with Primeval Titan.
Exactly. Whenever your opponent finds a way to put Gristlebrand into play, it's just game over. You just can't do anything.
He gains you 7 life.
Why did they put lifelink on this thing for some reason, right?
That is kind of weird.
Yeah. I understand the flying, but why does it have lifelink, right?
What are you thinking, Aaron Forsythe?
Yeah, this card is just absolutely unreal. They get to just refill their hand, put a bunch of Force of Wills in their hand.
I've said multiple times. I'll draw 28, actually. Thank you.
Yeah, with that exact tone. I'm sure that's anybody who plays Gristlebrand just sounds like that. Thank you very much. I'm going to take 14 cards and put it into my hand. You loser. All right, but yes. Gristlebrand, number 3, incredibly powerful magic card. Okay, now we're going to turn back the clock a little bit. A little bit of nostalgia here, kind of weighing in why it's number 2. But coming in at number 2, top flyer of all time, we have Birds of Paradise. The original mana creature.
I don't even think this is on here for nostalgic purposes. Like, this is still a staple in modern, all too, right. You know?
Big shout out to Worm. Big Worm using the proper art for Birds of Paradise. Look at that. Is that Alpha?
It's Alpha.
That is an Alpha Birds of Paradise picture. Look at that.
I bet it's gorgeous.
It is gorgeous. The whatever pixelated version.
There it is. It came up. Well, like, I'm watching this. I'm watching the stream itself, so it's like...
Oh, yeah.
10 seconds, but 20 seconds behind.
Oh, it is nice. It is nice. It's also just hundreds and hundreds of dollars, but...
I mean, that one looks near mint as well, so I assume...
Yes, that picture of a Bird of Paradise is near mint.
That is not an actual card, ladies and gentlemen, just so you know.
But, you know, as much as nostalgia you get about, you know, people, all these people spamming Stormcrow or what have you, but Birds of Paradise, yeah. This thing is so powerful. It has stood the test of time, right? You look at a lot of these other cards, right? And... You know, a lot of these cards were like good in standard or whatever. Birds of Paradise has been around since Alpha and is still seeing play, right? You're still seeing this in modern. You're still seeing this in like your collected company decks.
Not only that, but like this kind of card, like this Llanowar Elf, like this is a kind of card that has proven to be too powerful to see reprints now. Like, they don't make one mana accelerants anymore, and Birds of Paradise was the cream of the crop.
Oh yeah. Any color. Just
any color is insane.
It just gets the job done. Yeah.
Like, this lets you play, like, turn one Dual Lander Shocklands, second turn, Unlicensed Disintegration.
Yeah.
How do you beat that?
Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
You can do that. I mean, best card in Standard, so I can't even.
You can go turn one Tree of Tales into Bird of Paradise, turn two any red or black land, Unlicensed Disintegration, take three.
Yeah, kill your Bird of Paradise. Tempo.
What do you do?
Tempo.
Nothing.
Tempo.
Pack up your cards.
That's it. Tempo. Yeah. All right. So that was our number two.
Throw your opponent's deck on the floor. Get out of there.
That's it. Deck dropped. All right. Our number one shouldn't really come as a surprise. I see a lot of people have already kind of guessed what number one is. Coming in at number one, it's a flip card. Insectile Aberration.
Everybody knew. They all knew.
We can't say Delver of Secrets because that one doesn't actually have flying.
That's not the card we're looking at.
Right. We're looking at the flip version, which is the Insectile Aberration. We talked about how busted Toolcraft Exemplar is, 1-mana 3-2. Try a 1-mana 3-2 flyer.
No matter how much you want to contest this, it's such an obvious pick. Like, it's archetype defining, not only when it was in Standard, but like since it was in Standard and in multiple formats. It's still a archetype defining multiple archetypes in every shard or wedge in Modern and Legacy.
Is this the best one drop of all time, or is it? I think we did this. It might be top three, right? Deathrite Shaman
It's got to be top three.
Yeah, yeah. It's
He's infinitely more play than Deathrite Shaman, even. You know, like you got Jeskai Sultai and Grixis Delver decks in both Modern and Legacy. Like,
yeah, I would imagine it would be in all the Delver decks. That would be my guess. You'd
think that, but I don't know, man.
Ooh, I got some secret tech. I'm gonna play Grixis Delver, no Delver. Yeah.
They'll never know.
They'll never
find
out.
No Delver. That's just natural order Delver.
They'll never find out. But yes, this Delver has just been an amazing card since its inception. You've had basically decks just kind of be built around this one drop. You build your entire deck to basically play turn one Delver, jam a ton of spells in your deck, protect the Delver, and win the game. And it's a proven strategy that has worked in Standard, Modern, and of course, now where it's most dominant, Legacy.
Yeah, it's
no surprise.
It's surprising because it's a small dude. Like, why can't I just kill this easier? Nope.
It's a small 1-mana 3-2 flyer is a pretty big game.
Yeah, it's a 3-2, but like, dude, I could shock it.
Oh, you can fatal push it too. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm saying that's my point. Like, it should be easier to kill this creature because it's literally just a vanilla. It's essentially a vanilla creature once it flips. You know.
The thing is, like, for me, this probably wouldn't be my number one flyer because my Delvers never flip. Right? So, like, when I peek, you know, I'm just like, all right, 60% Delver of Secrets.
I've never actually played an Insectile Aberration before.
Yeah, my Delvers never flip. So, you know, this wouldn't make my top eight personally, but I understand. I respect it. You know, when we were kind of coming up with the list, I was like, I can see how you guys think Delver is number one, and I'm not going to fight you guys. It's a pretty good card.
Yeah, I agree. Like, it's
pretty good Magic card.
I don't like it. I don't want it to be, but I think it is. Like, it just feels ubiquitous, you know?
Yeah. All right, well, there you have it, folks. That was our top eight flyers for the week. I want to thank you so much, Frank, for
Anytime,
being on the
buddy.
Show.
I'm glad you and I finally got to do this. Me and Mashi were running the gamut here, and then
oh yeah,
never got to do a Paul and Frank version.
Yeah, this was like so much more fun, probably.
Yeah, well, we don't have to invite him next time.
Yeah,
either,
and like that's the thing. We don't have to fake our feelings, you know?
Yeah, it's just all honesty.
We're just buddy-buddy. This is great. This is a lot of fun.
Yeah, it doesn't feel forced or like.
Can we just can I just be like, hey, Mashi, just enjoy Australia for another week. We'll just the Paul and Frank show. We'll just call it that.
Because he's a little awkward, right? You know, and he kind of smells a little bit.
Yeah, yeah. We just don't even have to call it Magic TV. Just the Paul and Frank show, or Frank and Paul, however you wanna.
No, you go first. No, oh yeah.
Oh yeah. That's pretty generous of you.
I think it also has a better flow to it. I think Paul and Frank has a better flow.
All right. Fair enough. All right. Well, thank you for watching the Paul and Frank show. Really, really do appreciate all of you guys for tuning in and watching this week's Top 8. I will be back at it next week. Mashi may or may not be here. It's not clear because, of course, he is in Brisbane. But if not, we will have capable and better replacements at the ready. Thank you, Frank, so much for joining us.
Anytime, man.
Have a great evening, everybody.